The son of the Philippines' Justice Secretary acquitted of illegal drug possession.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. apologizes to thousands of passengers affected by the New Year's Day air traffic fiasco.
The Philippines' unemployment rate slides to a 17-year low in November.
And Republican leader Kevin McCarthy loses a historic 11th vote for the House speakership.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Curl.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. The son of Philippine Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Rimulya walks free just hours after he was acquitted of drug possession. Juanito Jose Rimulya III was arrested in October 2022 after receiving a package containing over ₱1 million worth of high-grade marijuana. But a Las Piñas court ruled there was no clear evidence that Rimulya intended to possess illegal drugs. His camp believes the Justice Secretary's son was framed.
Now we have more time to analyze and study who is the person, the mastermind of this effort. The father of the accused is a government official. So in marami ng mga parang yung sila ng mga makakaaway o may intention gumawa ng masama sa kanila.
The younger Rimulya is still facing a separate complaint for drug importation and violation of customs laws.
We have been acquitted with possession. There can be no importation if there is no possession. So we are confident that this case will actually bar the prosecution of our client in that case.
Philippine Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos defends his call for police officials to resign out of courtesy as government cracks down on those involved in the illegal drug trade. Abalos clarifies his statement was an appeal and not an order. Critics have said his statement is a violation of the human rights of police officers. But the Interior Chief asserts the current situation calls for extraordinary measures.
Pero tayo procedure, may batas tayo, but you know, these are extraordinary times. They've got so much power, they've got so much money, at ito yung mga tao, mga pumapatay, hindi biro ito if you're on the ground. Kaya nga ito yung kakaibang approach, kaya nga ito yung very radical, very bold move.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. backing his Interior Secretary's approach to the drug problem.
We were planning this for a while. Well, let me be very clear. Remember during the campaign, nung tinatanong ako kung ano yung gagawin natin tungkol sa drug war or drug problem. This is it. We approach it in an entirely different way. Alam naman natin na yung problema sa drugs, hindi mangyayari yan kung hindi kasabwat yung mga iba dyan sa police. We are just cleansing the ranks and trying to see and making sure that yung mga opisyal na natitira sa atin ay maaasahan natin.
A former high-ranking official of the PNP also backs the call of Interior Secretary Abalos. Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong believes the decision was based on a lengthy consultation process. He also sees it as a crucial step in restoring the public's trust on the police force.
Nakakalungkot na maski na alam mo na iyang may mga matataas na opisyal may link sa drug dealings. Kumisang kulang ka ng ebidensya. Kaya matagal ang pagkuha ng ebidensya, matagal ang pag-file ng kaso. Kaya kumisang na-frustrate ka eh. Alam mo naman ang Philippine National Police, crucial institution yan eh. Ngayon eh, yan ang tinitignan eh. Kung mabagal ang action ng gobyerno at ang leadership, mawawalan talagang tiwala ng taong bayan. Ngayon, ginawa ni SILG, action agad. Pero hindi ito knee-jerk reaction, hindi ito whimsical na decision. Pinag-aralan talaga ito.
Magalong is part of the 5-member committee tasked to review the courtesy resignations of police officials.
For the group Volunteers Against Crime and Corruption, the Interior Secretary's call is not a wise move. It insists there's no need for all third-level police officials to resign, since only a handful of cops have been linked to the illegal drug trade.
We are suggesting, why don't you file cases dun sa mga identified police personnel. Anyway, nandiyan naman yung ano, no? Nandiyan yung mga Directorate for Intelligence, the IMEG, no? Yung Integrity Monitoring Group, and also the DI, Directorate for Intelligence, wherein they can gather information, summarize, validate yung mga informations na kailangan to prosecute and put them for summary dismissals.
The Commission on Human Rights also weighing in on Secretary Abalos's appeal. It says a resignation or removal from office of a police officer is only the first step in the pursuit of justice and not an omission of liability. The CHR stressed accountability must be carried out to its fullest extent. The commission now urges the Interior Department and the police to investigate and file cases against cops involved in drug-related deaths. It adds, only through systemic action against corruption can citizens feel assured that the law is properly enforced.
In other news, a maritime law expert tempers expectations following the second face-to-face meeting between President Marcos and his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping. Jay Patumbacal says it's too early to expect any results from their talks. As he points out, China is not known for giving concessions easily. But he did acknowledge some headways in negotiations between the two countries when it comes to dealing with maritime issues.
Xi Jinping has already, in a way, set long-term plans in motion. So it's not easy for China as well to make adjustments. No? I think that is the idea, or rather the statement that he will look for a compromise, however, is something that is a bit different from before, because normally people would probably expect, say, silence, no, or that some kind of stonewalling. So let us see. No, perhaps that is a sign that they are seriously considering how to respond.
Marcos flew to China on Tuesday for a packed 3-day visit. Marcos said she vowed to find a compromise to allow Filipino fishermen to return to traditional fishing grounds in disputed areas in the South China Sea.
For an international affairs analyst, the state visit of Marcos to China should be seen with a mix of optimism and realism. De La Salle University professor Renato De Castro says while both countries agree to pursue deeper bilateral ties, they want different results.
The name of the game that China would be playing under this administration is to try to win us away from the United States. But fortunately, President Marcos has strengthened our alliance, so this provides us a leverage. Unlike the previous administration, who distanced ourselves from the United States, which of course lower basically the stakes for China to win us, because anyway, we have already done it. We were just an equation to the overall picture of China. China looks at the world, or Beijing looks at the world, from a different prism. We are a great power. We are a middle kingdom. The Philippines is just one of those problems that we have to address in Southeast Asia.
After his trip to China, President Marcos is now inviting Chinese leader Xi Jinping to visit the Philippines. Upon his arrival Thursday night, Marcos said his engagements with Chinese leaders had been cordial and fruitful.
I think that this is a very good beginning. I do not believe this will be the last visit that we will be making to China, and we are anticipating, as I continually reiterated an invitation, to President Xi and Madam Pang to come to the Philippines and visit with us on perhaps a state visit, an official visit in the future.
She last visited the Philippines in 2018 as ties warmed between Manila and Beijing due to former President Rodrigo Duterte's pivot to China. Meanwhile, the Philippines and China have inked a deal to enhance digital cooperation. The deal was one of 14 bilateral agreements signed during Marcos's state visit to China. Information and Communications Technology Chief Ivan Uy says the deal covers the exchange of knowledge and technical expertise in artificial intelligence, cloud computing, 5G, and robotics, among others. He adds, the deal will strengthen digital cooperation between the two countries, especially in telecommunication, digital governance, and radio spectrum management.
After China, President Marcos is set to visit another Asian superpower next month. Marcos says he'll make a state visit to Japan around the second week of February. Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida extended the invitation to Marcos during their meeting on the sidelines of the United Nations General Assembly in New York last year.
The agenda? Well, the agenda will be what will be a continued discussion of what we started in New York, which essentially centers around economic security. Because with the Japanese have many concerns about regional security, and we are seen, of course, the Philippines is seen as an important part of maintaining that security in partnership with friends and partners like Japan and the other countries around the Indo-Pacific, Asia-Pacific region.
Before visiting Japan in February, Marcos will fly to Davos in Switzerland later this month to attend the World Economic Forum.
President Marcos inspected the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Terminal 3, seeing the place for the first time since the New Year's Day air traffic mess. In a press briefing, Marcos apologized to the thousands of affected passengers. He also commended airport officials for getting the system up and running in just 6 hours after the fiasco.
It is very unfortunate, and this is not something that, of course, none of us wanted this to happen. And we have tried our best to support, to make sure that those who were affected, and it is a large number. Ang estimate na nakita ko, 64,000 ang apektadong pasahero. At ginawa naman namin, tiniyak namin na meron naman silang support. In other words, meron silang pinapakain natin, meron silang pupuntahan, hindi naman sila basta't pinabayaan.
The Civil Aeronautics Board sees a need to update the 10-year-old Air Passenger Bill of Rights in the wake of that massive air travel disruption. Jackie Manabat has the details.
Claire Javila's family ran out of cash, so they spent the night at the NAIA Terminal 3 floor. They spent $20,000 on a hotel while waiting for a rebooked flight to Bohol. They were supposed to hold a family reunion in Bohol on New Year's Day, not knowing they will end up waiting for days, stressed and anxious.
Grabe po yung mga yung mga presyo din po kasi sa hotel, ang mamahal po. Wala rin po kaming dalang cash kasi hindi naman po namin inaasahan na ganito nga po yung mangyayari. Yun po. Grabe po, hanggang 5 a.m. po gising kami. Pagod na pagod po kami.
Jake Galliardo gave up as soon as his flight was canceled and told to try to rebook again. He looked for alternative ways to reach Metro Manila from Rojas, from buses to sea vessels, only to be caught again in a congestion at a seaport in Calapan, Oriental, Mindoro.
Nadagdagan pa yung problema namin. Ano ba naman to? Natrahedya ka na nga sa Rojas City. Pagdating mo pa sa Calapan, trahedya pa rin, ma'am. Kumbaga, tinuhog ko na nga lahat eh. From Visayas to Mindoro to Batangas. Para makabalik lang dito, ma'am. Kasi nga may commitment ako araw-araw.
Javiles and Gallardo may have a different take on how they responded to the massive cancellation of flights when the Air Navigation System of Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines, or CAAP, failed. But they both spent more than what they paid for their flight ticket, and both felt they were neglected in a situation where it was not even their fault.
Tama na yung sisihan-sisihan doon. Ang akin, ma'am, unang-una, preventable yung crisis. Pangalawa, in-inform dapat ang public.
When CAAP suspended flights for almost 10 hours on New Year's Day, CAAP said they had to make sure that the flying public is safe while they repair the equipment. Out of the 65,000 overseas Filipino workers were prioritized in terms of assistance.
Sa ngayon, tinutulungan na lang muna natin na yung continuing accommodation na mga may mga rebooked flights. Sa aking observation, ang pinaka-latest na mga rebooked flights ay around January 6 to 7. Kaya ang tanong nila noong January 1, handa ba ang DMW OWA na sila ay ma-accommodate until sila ay makalipad? So, simple lang ang tugon ni Secretary Toots at ni Admin Arnel. Yes, you can be accommodated until yung rebooked flights ninyo. So, sila po ay nasa hotel, nag-aantabay, naghihintay ng kanilang rebooked flights.
The Civil Aeronautics Board said several passengers approached them to lodge a complaint because of the hassles and ordeal they went through. One of the agency's mandate is to uphold the rights of the air travelers based on the Air Passenger Bill of Rights. The regulatory agency says their office could only do so much with the complaints related to the New Year Day air travel fiasco. They could not compel airlines to compensate the passengers because it was not the airline's fault, or demand CAAP to pay damages to the passengers.
Pagdating sa complaint, ang first question is, kanino, kung against the airline, medyo uphill, ano? Kasi force majeure dahil hindi naman kasalanan ng airline yung cancellation. Ngayon, kung mayroong bad faith at negligence sa handling sa kanila, uphill pa rin dahil yun nga, limited din yung obligasyon ng airline sa isang ganitong sitwasyon. No? Against the government, that's a legal question. At kung mayroong negligence at bad faith din ng public officers, maaaring maging basis din yan. Ano? But not in general.
CAB also acknowledges the need to update the Air Passenger Bill of Rights, which was crafted over 10 years ago. Local airlines, on their part, waived rebooking fees while continuously assisting passengers with the rescheduling of their flights. Affected international airlines are also doing the same. For Transportation Secretary Jaime Bautista, while the airlines are not obligated to provide assistance, it is their moral obligation to do so.
Wala po kaming contractual obligation. Although pwedeng sabihin na meron tayong moral obligation dito sa mga pasahero.
On Thursday, transportation officials will face the Senate on the air travel fiasco. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
In other news, the National Telecommunications Commission says over 8% of all active SIMs have been registered as of January 4, 2023. That translates to more than 14 million SIM cards, half of which are under smart communications. The goal is 100% registration rate by April 26, 2023. Authorities also remind the public SIM registration is free. The ABS-CBN News team was able to find social media posts advertising SIM registration services for 10 pesos per SIM. The NTC said the culprits of this scam will be punished accordingly.
The Philippine Health Department allays fears over the XBB.1.5 subvariant. This is despite the World Health Organization's warning that Omicron sublineage is the most transmissible and most immune evasive yet. Acting Health Secretary Maria Rosario Vergere says there's no need to fear as long as the public exercises caution.
Hindi po natin kailangang matakot. Kailangan lang we are continuously vigilant. Kailangan magpabakuna tayong lahat ng COVID-19 vaccine. Kailangan alam natin kung kailan tayo magsusuot ng mask at kung kailan hindi tayo magsusuot ng mask.
It's all systems go for this year's celebration of the Black Nazarene. As Jeff Caparaz tells us, authorities expect the number of devotees participating in the event to match pre-pandemic levels.
Over 5,000 security forces were deployed in a send-off ceremony in Manila for the celebration of the Black Nazarene this year. The policemen came from 5 police districts of the National Capital Region Police Office and other force multipliers from other agencies. Manila Mayor Hany Lacuna reminded the security forces to enforce maximum tolerance.
Inaasahan ko po ang inyong maximum tolerance. Ako po ay nakikiusap na personal na inyong pong pagkahabaan ang inyong pangunawa at ang inyong pagpapasensya. Maaasahan ko ba kayo?
Before the send-off, Lacuna and Manila Police Director Police Brigadier General Andre Dison conducts an inspection to Quirino Grandstand. They made sure that the safety of devotees are ensured and the grandstand is cleaned for the start of Pagpupugay this Saturday. For the Pagpupugay, lines for the persons with disabilities, those who are ill, senior citizen, men and women are separated. If in case rain starts to pour, devotees are advised to wear transparent ponchos and raincoats for security reasons.
In-encourage po natin na magsuot ng kapote na transparent, yung kita po yung loob. Ang worry po namin kasi pag nagpayong, baka may magkatusukan eh. Lalo na po't marami yan. Ina-anticipate na po namin na marami po talagang makikilahok sa wakote. Hopefully, talaga tumigil po ako ang lalad.
Lacuna expects that this will not be followed and for humanitarian reasons, the director of the Manila PNP will tighten security protocols.
Bagko sa inspeksyon na lang natin maigi po yung mga payong dahil minsan yung payong nagiging taguan ito ng armas. So sisiguraduhin natin na ang bawat papasok na nakapayong ay safe yung daladala niyang payong, sir. Ipiprisk na lang po natin, we'll just make sure na wala silang dalang deadly weapon.
On the Walk of Faith on Sunday, the Philippine National Police again reminded devotees not to bring their life-size replica of the Black Nazarene, as this will be mistaken for the original image used for the translation in the past. However, small-sized images that can be held by hand, holy rosaries, and other relics are allowed.
May checkpoints po tayo sa mga city limits ng Manila City. At pagdating dito na may makita tayo, ipapatabi po natin at hindi po natin papayagan na makapasok dito, sir, or mag-join sa Walk of Faith. Baka mapagkamalian na yun ang imahe, so yun na rin po ang iniiwasan natin.
Even if translation is canceled this year and the Walk of Faith will be done instead, authorities expect devotees to reach pre-pandemic numbers. Starting Friday, January 6 at 10 p.m. to January 9, Independence Road, Katigbak Drive, South Drive, and parts of Rojas Boulevard will be closed to motorists. At 7 p.m. on Saturday, roads around Capo Church will be closed, particularly Quezon Boulevard from A. Mendoza to Quezon Bridge, España from Campa to A. Mendoza, Evangelista Street from Plaza San Juan to Recto, parts of Raon, stretch to P. Paterno Street, Carriedo Street, Palanca Street, and Busto Street, parts of Rizal Avenue northbound of MacArthur Bridge, Recto Avenue, and Nicanor Reyes Street from España to Recto. Ambulant vendors are not allowed on the celebration for security reasons, but the Manila Police District says it is not monitoring any threats prior to the celebration. For devotees, it is important to fulfill their devotion, as some of them, as they say, were given miracle when they prayed and paid their respect to the Black Nazarene. Jeff Caparaz, ABS-CBN News.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with PAGASA forecaster Raymond Ordinario. Raymond?
Yes, Ron. Good afternoon. And this is our forecast for the next 24 hours.
still Sheridan has affected the eastern section of southern Luzon and Visayas, and bringing cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over the Quezon province, Bicol region, eastern Visayas, Caraga, and Davao region. Also, the northeast monsoon is still affecting the rest of Luzon, bringing cloudy skies with rains over Cagayan Valley, Cordillera, and central Luzon. Meanwhile, in Metro Manila and Ilocos region, we're going to expect a generally fair weather condition apart from some light rains. The rest of the country, we're going to expect generally fair weather condition apart from some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms. The temperature in Metro Manila tomorrow will range from 24 to 29 degrees Celsius, around 16 to 20 in Baguio City, and in Tagaytay City is around 20 to 28 degrees Celsius. Because of the surge of our northeast monsoon, we still have a gale warning raised over the seabirds of Batanes, Cagayan, Babuyan Island, northern coast of Ilocos Norte, Isabela, Aurora, the northern Quezon, including the northern and eastern coast of Polillo Island, Camarines Norte, northern coast of Camarines Sur, Catanduanes, eastern coast of Albay, the eastern coast of Sorsogon, northern and eastern Samar, the western coast of Ilocos Norte, and Ilocos Sur. We're still advising our fisher folks and those who have small sea craft not to venture out of those seabirds because we're still expecting high waves that will be dangerous for those type of sea vessel. And as of now, we are monitoring a low pressure area outside the Philippine area of responsibility, and it's around 1,310 kilometers east of Western Mindanao. It is still too far of our area of responsibility, and it will not directly affect any parts of our country. And that's the latest from the Weather Forecasting Center of Pagasa, Raymond Ordinario reporting.
Thanks for that, Raymond. Up next, Ukraine rejects Russia's declaration for a ceasefire on Orthodox Christmas.
And unemployment in the Philippines eases in November. More news when we return.
Thanks for watching Top Story. Here again at the headlines, the son of the Philippines' Justice Secretary acquitted of illegal drug possession.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. apologizes to thousands of passengers affected by the New Year's Day air traffic fiasco.
The Philippines' unemployment rate slides to a 17-year low in November.
And Republican leader Kevin McCarthy loses a historic 11th vote for the House speakership.
The impasse in the U.S. House of Representatives continues for a third day. The lower chamber adjourns for the night after a historic 11 attempts to elect a House Speaker. Kevin McCarthy, who has led House Republicans since 2019, has failed yet again to convince his colleagues to vote for him. Republicans aligned with former President Donald Trump believe McCarthy is not conservative enough to battle Democrats. The deadlock is stalling any legislative business, and new lawmakers cannot even be sworn in until a speaker is elected.
President Joe Biden unveils a new policy to crack down on illegal immigration at America's southern border. Biden announced the expansion of a Trump-era policy that allows authorities to deport migrants illegally crossing the U.S.-Mexico border. Biden also says the U.S. is undertaking a program to accept up to 30,000 migrants per month from Latin American countries. Biden's pronouncements came ahead of his visit to Texas on Sunday, his first trip to the border since taking office. The American president has faced criticism from Republicans as record numbers of migrants cross the border.
Russia's assault on Ukraine takes a halt, at least for the weekend, as President Vladimir Putin orders a truce for the Orthodox Christmas. Putin's declaration came at the request of Russia's Orthodox Church leader as the two nations observed the holiday on January 7th. This is the first time that Russia ordered a full ceasefire since launching its offensive in Ukraine in February last year. The Kremlin says Putin has asked Kyiv to declare its own truce. But Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has rejected this, saying this may be Moscow's attempt to stop Kyiv's military advances. Meanwhile, the U.S. views Putin's move with skepticism. Washington State Department describes the ceasefire as cynical, saying it comes just days after Moscow's attacks on several Ukrainian cities during the New Year weekend. It adds Russia could prove it is serious about achieving peace by withdrawing its forces from Ukraine.
China is set to reopen its Hong Kong border on Sunday after a three-year closure due to the pandemic. Beijing's Affairs Office for Hong Kong and Macau has announced quarantine-free travel between the mainland and its special administrative regions will gradually resume this weekend. Asia's economic giant will also add more flights between China, Hong Kong, and Macau. China has said international tourists and returning residents will no longer need to isolate themselves upon their arrival to the mainland starting January 8. That's even as it continues to deal with a surge in COVID infections.
The unemployment rate in the Philippines improves to 4.2% in November from 4.5% the previous month. That's the lowest in over 17 years. This translates to around 2.18 million unemployed Filipinos in November, lower than the 2.24 million in October. But underemployment worsened, coming in at 14.4%. The number of underutilized workers rose by 488,000 in November. The services sector remained the biggest employer, followed by agriculture and industry. Meanwhile, the fisheries and aquaculture industries lost the most jobs, followed by education, public administration and defense, and construction. The Philippine Statistics Authority attributes this increase to the holiday jobs created in the last quarter of 2022.
Ang malaking nag-contribute sa employment ay, for example, yung wholesale and retail trade. Normally kasi may seasonality factor talaga dito, so I'm not really sure. When we report this December, my expectation is that there'll still be an increase because of the holidays. Yung manufacturing, which is the second, ito yung may dagdag month on month ng mga 668,000. Nakikita rin naman namin ito doon sa iba pang mga datos natin. So may expectation na baka dito ang tuloy-tuloy na pagdagdag sa mga employed persons sa itong mga buwan, unang buwan ng 2023.
Unemployers Group says while the improving jobless rate is a welcome development, this is just the result of people returning to their old jobs. That's why Employers Confederation of the Philippines President, Sergio Ortiz Luis Jr., urges the government to boost assistance for micro, small, and medium enterprises, which are still on the recovery stage from the effects of the pandemic.
We have a problem really with the micro enterprises. Mm-hmm. 90% of our enterprises are micro. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of people also in the informal sector, like in the agriculture. We should focus on them. In training, in assistance, wherever we can, for credit facilities. We have to give really incentive to companies who are encouraging creating employment.
President Marcos downplays the continued rise in consumer prices in the country. He points out December's 8.1% inflation is only up slightly from 8% in the previous month. Despite this, Marcos believes there is a need to improve production, especially on agricultural products.
At least 8.1, nag-increase lang ng 0.1, and the rate of increase is really slowing. It's still agricultural products. 38% of the inflation is now, 11% is fuel, 38% is agricultural products pa rin. Kaya kailangan talagang ayusin yung import, yung production natin.
As inflation eats away at people's pockets, Filipino households may also have to brace for higher power and water rates. Alvin El Chico tells us why.
Another power rate hike looms in the first month of 2023 for customers of the country's biggest electricity distributor. Meralco spokesman Joe Saldarriaga says there is a possibility of higher rate for January due to the completion of one of the three remaining refunds and more expensive electricity costs from the spot market and emergency power supply agreement. Meralco was forced to source power from the spot market and another power plant after a unit of San Miguel suspended its supply agreement after going to court.
Most of these factors point to a possible, no? Hindi ko pa naman sinasabing sigurado na, probably an upward adjustment. Pagandaan lang, kasi binigay ko na nga sa'yo, Alvin, itong mga conditions that may lead to a possible, no? Let me emphasize that, a possible upward adjustment in rate.
Meralco has also clarified that its power supply to the airport's air traffic management center remained stable and did not cause the glitch in the control tower.
Stable po yung supply namin up to the metering point, up to our facility, hanggang dun sa lubong nung kanilang facility. Wala ho kaming nakitang kahit na anumang problema po sa panig na Meralco.
Meanwhile, the chief regulator of the Metropolitan Water Works and Sewerage System alerts consumers of the higher water rates beginning this month's billing. Manila Water's rate will be higher by more than 8 pesos per cubic meter, while Maynilad will impose a hike of more than 3 pesos per cubic meter.
Sana po maintindihan po ng publiko na kailangan po natin ito. Ito po ay na-accumulated po dahil po nagkaroon po tayo ng COVID lockdown. At hindi po tayo nagtaas ng presyo ng tubig, ay nag-ipon-ipon na po ito eh. So ayaw po natin na mas lalo pong pabigatin sa ating mga consumers in the future pag i-defer pa natin.
The regulator has also warned Maynilad to fix the problem with its Putatan Water Treatment Plant as water service interruptions will affect its exceeding rate hikes.
We are also studying again imposing another financial penalty. At ito po ang financial penalty na ito ay marirebate ulit po sa ating publiko, lalo na sa mga affected customers. Hindi po nila pwede makuha ang second tranche nila itong January 1, 2024. Ito po ay next year na. At hindi po nila ito makukuha pag hindi po nila maayos ang kanilang servisyo.
Maynilad has issued an advisory Thursday asking customers to store water due to continuous rainfall. Maynilad says the rains may lead to increased turbidity, which will lessen the production of potable water. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
The three-day rally of the Philippine Stock Exchange loses steam as investors digested the country's latest jobs report. Michelle Long reports.
Markets in Asia traded mixed while U.S. stock futures picked up Friday ahead of a crucial jobs data that will help direct the path forward for the Federal Reserve's tightening cycle. Philippine shares giving up some of the recent day's gains as investors locked in profit. Local investors also digested a mixed bag of jobs data. While unemployment rate in the Philippines went down to 4.2%, the lowest in over 17 years, underemployment picked up, indicating declining quality of jobs and a challenge to cope with soaring prices of goods. For the day, the PSE index lost 1.4%, settling at 66.67, while still notching a weekly gain. Sun Life Investment Management's Mike Enriquez says now is a good time for investors to rebalance their portfolio to include more stocks, especially on strong corporate earnings and better visibility on central bank tightening.
I think valuations continue to be very low at these levels, especially on the fact that earnings growth potential for the equity market continues to be very strong, at least for the Philippines. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one strong reason for investors to start considering equities, although fixed income definitely continues to be quite attractive, especially with the long-term rates.
While Regina Capital's Colleen Aglavio says 6,800 is proving to be a tough resistance.
7K is very much possible in the first half of the year, and that's only if the index doesn't correct further past 6,400.
In corporate stories, Robinson's Retail is buying an additional 4.4% stake in BPI for an undisclosed amount. RRHI is set to acquire the 4.4% effective equity interest from Iran Investment, an affiliate of Singapore's sovereign wealth fund, GIC. Through preferred shares, GIC via Iran currently owns 21.9% of Lion Tide Holdings, which in turn has a 20% equity interest in BPI. This comes 3 months after BPI and the Gokongwei-led JG Summit Capital and Robinsons Retail approved the merger of BPI and Robinsons Bank, with BPI as the surviving entity. Post-merger, Robinsons Bank shareholders will collectively hold a 6% stake in the Ayala-led bank. RRHI President and CEO Robina Gokongwei-Pes says this partnership will accelerate their vision to become a leading retailer with excellent financial products for both customers and suppliers. Speaking of BPI, it has priced its 1.5-year RISE bond due 2024, where it plans to raise at least 5 billion pesos. The bonds will carry an interest rate of 5.75% per annum, paid quarterly. Offer period runs from January 9 through 13, ending 1 week earlier. Proceeds will be used to finance or refinance requirements of eligible MSMEs. In other news, RFM Corporation's president and CEO Joey Concepcion is more bullish about 2023, hoping inflation is close to peaking and margins can improve. But Concepcion warns if commodity prices remain elevated, they might have to pass on a part of the increases to consumers again.
We're in the range of 5 to 10%, depending on the product itself. No? If the raw materials, for example, like in the case of wheat, has jumped up tremendously, no, from as low as 280 per metric ton to 300 per metric ton to 500 per metric ton, you have no choice. In the same manner, we were very lucky to hedge our milk prices and to some extent our sugar prices way back then, a year ago, at below 3,000. Mm-hmm. But that inventory is running out, and by March.
And finally, Alliance Select Foods disclosed the SEC en banc on December reversed an earlier ruling that cleared a private placement made in 2014 and a stock rights offer in 2015 by a local firm, Strong Oak, effectively declaring the subscriptions void and canceled. That includes a 564 million peso private placement in exchange for 29% stake by Strong Oak. These placements had been the subject of boardroom feud several years back, with Singaporean shareholders led by a certain Hedi Yap Chua alleging mismanagement and self-dealing that resulted to a substantial dilution of their stake from 34% to less than 20%. The company says it will exhaust all legal remedies, including filing a petition for review with the Court of Appeals. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The anti-graft court has dismissed the forfeiture cases of former military controller Major General Carlos Garcia following the completion of the plea bargaining agreement between him and the Office of the Ombudsman. The Sandigan Bayan 4th Division, in its resolution dated December 7, 2022, said the Philippine government, as petitioner, has claimed that substantially all of the property sought to be forfeited in Garcia's criminal case have already been recovered under the plea bargaining agreement. The resolution was penned by Associate Justice Bayani Jacinto with the concurrence of Division Chairperson Michael Frederick Musni and Associate Justice Lorifel Lakap Pahimna. Last year, the Office of the Ombudsman turned over to the Bureau of Treasury 53 million pesos worth of checks and 11 titles to real properties that were part of the plea bargain agreement. Garcia, who was convicted and sentenced last year for the lesser offenses of direct bribery and facilitating money laundering, is currently detained at the New Bilibid Prison.
Free rides at the EDSA bus carousel may return soon. The newly appointed chairman of the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board says the program may resume in February as long as the budget department releases the funds approved by Congress. Chairman Teofilo Guadis III also hopes the free rides can last for the whole year.
Depende po sa kakayahan ng budget kung hanggang saan ho namin may stretch yung 1.4 billion na budget. But what I can assure you is that the government has been very cooperative ho. Ang sabi naman sa amin, pag kinapos po yung budget, they will make funds for it para tuloy-tuloy ho to year-round.
The Etsabus carousel had been free of charge since November 2020 when the government subsidized fares for passengers when the pandemic struck. The busways started charging fares again this week.
More drivers sought by Grab Philippines to improve its passengers' commuting experience. The ride-hailing service says it's looking for more drivers after government regulators opened over 4,000 slots for transportation network vehicles. Grab admits it experienced a shortage of drivers as a result of the pandemic, as some drivers looked for other job opportunities. It is optimistic that hiring more drivers will help meet the growing demand for transport services as the Philippine economy continues to reopen.
In sports, a Filipino-American is an early favorite for MVP honors of the National Hockey League. Steve Angeles returns with this report.
One of professional hockey's best players is a Filipino-American winger for the Dallas Stars. Now entering his third full season, 23-year-old Jason Robertson has steadily improved his game. Heading into the new year, Robertson is among the league leaders in goals, assists, and total points. His play has helped the Stars rise to the top of their conference. He's already been awarded the NHL Star of the Week 3 times this season and was November's Star of the Month. On Thursday, Robo was named an NHL All-Star, making him the first Filipino to receive the honor. All-Star Weekend will take place from November 3rd to 4th in Sunrise, Florida.
Just trying to stay confident, build off of last year, take even more strides in my game. Just really just be, you know, a better player for our team, and they trust me to do that every night, and that's what I'm going to do, and whatever happens, happens, but that's my goal.
In the NHL's history, it is believed that there have only been 4 Filipino players. Tim Stapleton was the first, playing from 2008 to 2012 with the Toronto Maple Leafs, Atlanta Thrashers, and Winnipeg Jets. Jason Robertson's younger brother Nick plays for Toronto, while Matthew Dumba plays for Minnesota. All 3 except for Stapleton are currently active. Robertson hopes this could lead to more Filipinos lacing the skates and picking up the sticks.
Definitely, it's you know, a lot of responsibility for me, but I mean, I'm embracing it, and my family loves it, and I also have my little brother too. So it's all good. And when they see, you know, me being you know, a role model for the team and for the league, being a Asian hockey player, Filipino hockey player, it's definitely inspiring. And hopefully, we'll see a new wave of kids come along.
On this recent road trip to Southern California, the players' dads came along, including Robertson's dad, Yu. Robertson's mother, Mercedes, has roots in Bohol and Zambales in the Philippines. Yu takes great pride in seeing how his sons have inspired more Filipinos to take an interest in hockey.
The boy comes up to him and he's got a Philippine sweatshirt on. And he singles you out. He immediately goes up, signs his sweatshirt and everything. He started to bring the awareness of the sport to the community, and through his relatives who didn't know anything about hockey. Even when when the boys were growing up.
Before the season started, the 2017 second round draft pick inked a 4-year, $31 million contract extension with the Stars, making sure his knack for scoring continues in the Lone Star State, hoping to win his first Stanley Cup since 1999.
Robertson will have a chance to celebrate his Pinoy pride on the ice when the Stars return to face the Kings on January 19th, the night that the Kings will be hosting its Filipino Heritage Celebration. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
From dramas to documentaries, our resident movie critic Manny the Movie Guy gives us a peek of his favorite films at the Palm Springs International Film Festival.
It's time for the 80 for Brady starting lineup.
Lily Tomlin, Rita Moreno, Sally Field, Jane Fonda. All the icons in one movie. 80 for Brady. The sports comedy is the opening night film of the festival. It's about 4 friends who traveled to Houston in 2017 to watch their hero, Tom Brady, and the New England Patriots play in the Super Bowl. In the Talking Pictures category, Anna Kendrick shines in Alice Darling, a psychological drama about abusive relationships.
Alice!
Darling.
And under the queer cinema banner, look out for Esther Newton Made Me Gay, an eye-opening documentary on cultural anthropologist and icon Esther Newton. There's also the comedy God Save the Queens about drag queens in therapy.
What are you doing?
Comedian Jim Gaffigan plays dual roles in the smart sci-fi comedy Linoleum about space travels and broken dreams. Making its world premiere at the Fest is Shot in the Arm from Food Evolution director Scott Hamilton Kennedy. This hopeful documentary explores the anti-vax movement. Underworld cinema now is Ray Romano's heartfelt directorial debut, Summer in Queens. He plays a supportive dad who will do what it takes to ensure his son gets a college scholarship. And shining a spotlight on Palm Springs is Racist Trees.
As a kid growing up, they were just trees. But as we got older, we started to understand they were planted to hide this community because of the people who lived here.
This thoughtful documentary asked the question, was the planting of tamarisk trees along the historically black Lawrence Crossley neighborhood in Palm Springs a symbol of segregation?
Who wants them to stay for any reason?
I'd quite like to visit his grave.
And finally, on closing night, check out The Lost King. Sally Hawkins is fantastic as an amateur historian attempting to find the lost remains of King Richard III. This is from the Queen director, Stephen Frears.
An adult male.
I'm Manny, the movie guy for ANC.
And before we go, high-tech fashion and smart health gadgets are just some of the products showcased at this year's Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas. Bev Llorente tells us more.
The annual CES, or Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas, are sideshow media-only events showcasing live product demos from innovative companies. One such event is Pepcom's The Digital Experience, a festive interactive showcase of technology connecting exhibitors with the news media. Among the featured devices, these fashionable and high-tech audio earrings from Nova H1. These pearl earrings are embedded with wireless earphones, with each earring weighing 7 grams. Meanwhile, Paula Abdul's new line of smart audio glasses is a fashionable accessory that features Bluetooth 5.0 connectivity. There's no need to put anything on your ear to listen to music or your favorite podcast.
So we have 7 colors, they're all about 5.5 battery life, IP4 in terms of the water resistance.
This EV smart ring from Movano was designed to help track key health metrics. It provides details on heart, oxygen level, sleeping patterns, and women's menstrual cycles.
Just your composition changes, it has about 2 millimeters of give. So it has a little bit of flex to sort of flex with your body.
On the other hand, Friends AI-powered brain band claims to track and stimulate your brain activity for sleep, focus, and relaxation. Tired of taking your own selfies? Let this robot do it for you. This robot from Aeolus Robotics can also do chores such as UV germicidal disinfection and provide care for the elderly. From a new wave of wearable tech to digital fitness gadgets, thousands of startup companies at this year's CES are hoping to create some buzz and attract investors who can help their company grow. Bev Llorente, ABS-CBN News, Las Vegas.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove.